we knew there was a storm coming. Certainly the weather forecast was bad, and I was out on the seawall during the afternoon watching the waves, watching what the wind was doing, because it started off coming in pretty hard from the south, and you could see the wave trains and the white horses shooting up the bay in that direction. But during the course of the afternoon, you could see at first a subtle and then quite a dramatic change with the wave trains starting to come in towards us instead of going up the bay. And at the same time, the wind speed was really getting up. It was getting pretty puffy. And after a while, the actual shape of the sea changes. And I'm used to seeing that from my past life. And you realise that this was big waves building up. You start to lose the white horses off the top, and the waves look more like rolling lead sheeting. And by the time it started to get dark, I was getting seriously worried. Elderly lady who lives next door on her own had been persuaded her to go to her family inland, so I knew that she was okay. Other people living the other side, we would expect that the houses would not have a problem. Modern houses, big double glazed areas, you know, so, and pretty strong, hadn't suffered damage in the past. But as the evening went on, it was getting more and more violent. You could hear solid water hitting the house. You could hear huge amounts of shingle hitting the, not in my case, the windows, because I boarded them up. I'd spent the previous day and the previous morning getting as much boarding up on them as I could. But you could hear the shingle hitting it. You could hear a lot of movement outside. And if you looked out, you could see a huge amount of water coming over the seawall and actually running down the roadway and taking everything with it. By the time it's fully dark, it's difficult to do much about anything or to see what was really happening. But various people within the village were actually, by that stage, going around to people's houses to see if everybody was all right and to see if there was any damage actually happening. I'd happened to go down the road and met up with an acquaintance who sort of looks after a house that's more on the seaward side. And she said, "I think the front door's gone in. Can we go and have a look?" So I accompanied her there, and actually that's when I first met up with you. And it was clear that the front door had gone right in. The room was getting very wet. I think the windows are still intact at that stage, I'm not sure. But anyway, collectively we tried to move possessions and furniture and things to the back so that they'd have a little bit of shelter. But there wasn't anything very much more that could be done at that time, except to try and push the door back into the hole, but you knew that it would get forced through again. And realising that quite severe damage was starting to happen only just down the road, I was conscious that there's an elderly lady living on her own just next door but one to me, and that she might now be getting at risk. So I went in to see her and found, horrifyingly, that the outer layer of glass in her double glazed windows had gone. The inner glass, thank goodness, had held, because she was sitting in the room and could have been seriously damaged if that glass had gone and been swept over her. And the adjoining door to a small common hallway was still intact, but the outer door down there had been completely smashed down by the sea. So she was very much at risk, and I couldn't let her stay where she was. So I brought her back into my house here, and we sat down to have a cup of tea and try and keep calm about the situation. And I could hear water hitting my roof. I could hear all manner of stuff. One big crash didn't sound right, and I thought that's done some damage. Went upstairs and found that a bedroom window had been completely stove in, all the glass gone, glass all over the room, seawater coming in over the windowsill, soaking the whole room. Not a lot I could do about that at the time, but I did manage to get out to the garage and find a bit of board and nail it up to reduce the inrush at least, and then left that, came back down, and we carried on trying to have a sensible conversation about things and be philosophical about it all. And then I heard a very, very strong noise from the back of the house, and hadn't realised at the time what it was, but actually one of the coast guards who were down here told me later that he'd actually seen the wave come over the wall, about 30 feet above the wall, and as a large volume of water, it just fell on my roof. And that's done substantial damage. It's ripped a lot of tiles up, obviously. Some water has got through, not fortunately too much yet, but it's hit the roof bad. It's taken a lot of tiles off, and it may have done some structural damage to the roof. I don't know. I have builders coming out soon, I hope, to try and get up there and see what the state of play is. And the insurers will be sending an assessor around next week. But obviously, with all the stuff in Somerset as well, there are not going to be enough people to get everybody helped all at once. You know, it's going to take some time. When we came outside in the morning, I couldn't believe just how much rubble, how much really heavy masonry. The sea road here, between the actual sea road and the houses, there are a lot of pavements, if you like, and terraced pavements, which are covered in big slabs, big paving slab. Now, those weigh about 30, 35 kilos each, and they have been picked up and littered right down the sea road. They've travelled hundreds of yards in some cases, and even the concrete blocks that made up the terracing have been ripped out, thrown against houses, thrown down the road, done damage to houses. Although I do believe that most of the windows that have been pushed through and the doorways that have gone actually went just by the force of water, because mostly what's inside the houses is shingle, not large lumps of masonry. Most of the masonry, I think, has stayed outside. But I've been here a long time, and I've seen some bad storms. And in fact, this house itself was destroyed or partially destroyed in the 79 storm and then subsequently rebuilt. And yeah, there's been a few violent storms since then, but none that have caused any real damage like that. And to see the state of the sea road now is really, really pretty upsetting, because it's a good community, and you don't like seeing people's houses get bashed around like that. And of course, quite a number of the houses are actually people's holiday homes, and most of those owners have come down to see what it's like down here, and many of them are people who've only seen it on nice sunny days in the summer. And yeah, they might be aware that you can get some water over the wall and things can get a bit wet at times, but I think most of them are pretty shocked to see the damage that the sea has done on this occasion. I'm not surprised it's done that damage. We hear that the wind speed measured at Berry Head, which is literally the next headland around, was nearly 92 miles an hour that night. Now, that is well into hurricane force, even on the Beaufort scale. You're talking a lot of wind. And that sort of wind coming in from the southeast, which it did on that night, is bound to cause a lot of damage. It's, thank goodness, nobody in this village has been hurt at all. Well, I say nobody. I've fractured a wrist, but as a part of what was happening during the storm. But nobody has had anything worse than that. And quite honestly, the conditions that night and the way the houses have been hurt, had people been in the wrong place at the wrong time, somebody could have got seriously hurt. But thank goodness they haven't. And property can be fixed, things can be cleaned up, and we'll go ahead, I'm sure.
You were saying to me on the night, Bill, that everybody needed to wear helmets.
Yeah, absolutely. when I said that on the occasion, I didn't actually have one. I went out before I went round the village again, because a number of the residents here and the Coast Guard team, who I cannot praise highly enough, because they were going from the local Coast Guards from Dartmouth were going from house to house to make sure that everybody was safe and checking with people to know who was in the house, how many people there were, and making sure that they were safe outside. And then other residents were offering them accommodation for the night, because in most cases it wasn't safe to go back into the houses until the tide had passed and the storm had passed a little bit. So that, you know, that was really good to see people reacting like that, and very heartwarming. But no, certainly it wasn't safe outside without a helmet. A number of my ex-Coast Guard colleagues kept saying, you can't be out here without a helmet. So I still had one in the garage, and I wore that for the rest of the night. And yeah, glad I did. But it was a night where, you know, you needed to have only people who knew what they were doing outside.
Would you say you had plenty of help from emergency services, etc.? Well,
the police were down here because they'd had to close the road, obviously, because the beach and a lot of other stuff was washing over what we call Slapton Line, further down towards Dartmouth. And that was totally impassable, except for four-wheel drive vehicles driving over the top of vast mounds of shingle, broken fence posts, rock armour, big boulders that had been thrown up from the beach defences across the road. So the police had closed the road, the Coast Guard would as well. The police were probably a little short-handed. There was a lot of things happening right throughout the county that night. But they were doing what they could, and once the Coast Guard team were out here, I think they were pretty happy to let the Coast Guards do their job of searching the houses with all the PPE, the personal protection equipment they need, the life jackets, the helmets and stuff, which, you know, the average Bobby in his beat car doesn't actually have access to, not immediately anyway. So, yeah, no, the emergency services were good, and I have to say a big thank you to South Hams Council, who the next morning were out really pretty early on with big gangs of guys and big vans and truckloads of reinforcing timber and sheeting. And they went through every house in the village, every house on the seafront, boarding up over broken windows and boarding up for protection over windows that weren't particularly badly damaged. And those guys did a great job. And the next morning, the sea conditions were almost as bad. The sea was still coming over the wall in huge, great plumes and soaking all these guys while they were working. And it actually, as it got towards high water the night before, I think it had been about 10 o'clock in the morning, it was about 10:45. And when it came to that time, the police actually had to draw everybody back and say, no, don't go on the sea road until high water's passed. It's too dangerous. There is too much risk of these big lumps of masonry still being thrown around and hurting somebody. But the council, by that time, had done most of the boarding work that was needed. And, hugely impressed. They were a great help, because there could well have been more damage that morning had they not been out so promptly.
Now, Bill, we're expecting another storm this weekend. Could you give anybody any advice on this?
I think Bahamas are quite nice this time of year. No, but seriously, it's difficult to know exactly what's going to happen by the forecast, because what we're getting is a train of very deep lows coming across the Atlantic, and they're turning left when they get to the UK and travelling further up country. But exactly what time they turn left, it makes a huge difference to not the strength of wind that we get, but the direction of the wind. Hopefully, tonight, the wind is going to get very strong by midnight. We've got a high tide around about midnight or a little bit before. But the direction, we're told, will be southerly at that time. And if it's southerly, yes, there will be water coming over the wall, because that does still come over on that direction. But hopefully it won't be hitting the houses. Hopefully it won't be bringing any heavy stuff over the wall. And within a short space of time, that wind is supposed to go around to the northwest as the depression passes over us. The quicker that happens, the quicker we will have, you know, relative calm. The wind strength will still be there, but there won't be the risk from the sea. Hopefully, again, the sea won't have actually built up to the extent that it did on Tuesday night. So whatever there is will settle down a little bit quicker. Once we're into Saturday, the rest of the county, or southwest facing parts of the county and the coastline, are going to have a hard day. From what the forecasters tell us, right through Saturday, and it is very, very high winds through Saturday. They are talking 50 mile an hour winds for the duration of the day, which is serious. But hopefully, if the forecasters are right, the direction will all be west or southwest. And from that direction, we're sheltered by the hills at the back of the village. There'll be a lot of wind, and there may be a lot of loose roof slates and things flying around, but hopefully we won't be getting that force of water over the wall, because it was the water that was doing the damage. And so if we can get through to Sunday, another rough day maybe, and there's going to be rough days next week as well, but it's probably too far ahead to say exactly what directions are going to be involved. So everybody is hunkering down as much as they can, making their houses safe from further damage. There's no point in trying to clear up too much until this is all through. And most of us don't actually have the physical strength or the means of clearing up. It's going to be a long, slow process to remove all the shingle, which is badly contaminated with broken glass, so it can't be put back on the beach. It's got to go somewhere else. Hopefully councils will be able to help us in disposing of it, but it's probably going to be up to the householders to actually get it to somewhere where it can be picked up safely. The clear-up process is going to take some considerable time, but you can't do a lot until the weather has settled quite a bit more than it has at the moment. There's beautiful sunshine out there at the moment. The sea is absolutely flat, calm. It looks delightful. You can hardly imagine what it was like three nights before. And I fear that, you know, within the next 48, 72 hours, it's going to look a little bit like that again. But hopefully it won't be doing the damage this time.
Well, thank you very much, Bill, for your story and a good update on the weather forecast and what it's going to be like. And let's hope your wrist gets better pretty soon. I'm sure you're going to need it in the
I will indeed.
In the upcoming weather.
A lot of spade work and broom work to be done as well.